Dr. Samantha Cotrera here, the Principal Storytelling Officer for the Histoire Source Story video series, a video series where myself, but sometimes we have a French host, gets to talk with historians and archivists and artists and creators about one primary, usually primary source, and we talk about what is the source, what is the story, and how can it challenge Canadian history? Please make sure you follow us on all of our social media pages, especially as we go into the summer. I know teachers are at capacity right now. I mean, always at this time of year, but especially after the last couple of years that we've had. So thank you for the time that you've spent listening or watching to any of these videos. And I hope that in the summer when you refresh and restore a little bit, you can engage more with the sources and comment below and share and join the conversation about how you're using these sources in your classrooms and how you are challenging Canadian history with your pedagogies, your teaching, your assessments, your discussions, your using historical imagination, using these sources. And thank you so much for all of the views and the listens and the shares already. It's been really great. And we can't wait to finish this academic year and then start another full year of videos. Anyway, so it's been really, really great. Thank you again. Just a reminder that this conversation, like all the conversations, can be accessed in English or in French by looking at the subtitles below. So there are complete French and English subtitles below, depending on how you want to access this information. And this is actually a really interesting conversation because it could have been done with our French host. And I'll tell you why in a second. Well, I mean, you know why. It's because the person is Francophone. But because this source can be accessed in both English and French, and that's one of the reasons why I'm excited for it. So what are the three reasons why I'm excited for this talk? The first one is because it's just a fantastic source. This source is the memoir of Eddy Weetaltuk from the, it's called From the Tundra to the Trenches. And it is a memoir of an Inuit who was born in 1923, and then he joined the Canadian forces around the Korean War and fought in the Korean War and served the Canadian military for 15 years. He comes back to Canada and experiences racism. When he was a young boy, he went to residential school, and all of that is in this source. This is such a fantastic source. It is accessible. It is so easy to read. It is engaging. He's funny. He's witty. He brings himself into the story. He's not a victim, but all of the different elements of racism and nation building and what that looks like for Inuit people on their bodies, on their persons, as they are going through the literal world, because he goes overseas and he's in Europe and he's in Asia. There's so much to this source. And one of the reasons why we scheduled this for June is because I was like, I know everyone's busy in the summer relaxing, but also maybe prepping for September. And I really, really recommend that you pick this text up as a way to think about bringing it into your classrooms, as a way to hashtag challenge Canadian history. The second reason why I'm very excited for this, talking about this source, is because while Eddy has passed away, the introduction was written by Isabelle St-Amand, and she is who we're talking to today. One of the cool things about this series is I start by saying, you know, we'll talk to archivists and historians, but a lot of the people I've spoke to have not actually been like traditional historians. Isabelle is a professor in languages and linguistics and cultures at the University of Queens. And so she brings to this conversation a historical background, certainly, but also thinking of this as a text. So this is a really great conversation because you can bring so many things to an English class, for example, as a way to like, I want to say like cross-pollinate, but like create interdisciplinary lessons between you and another teacher or between you and a couple different classes. So it's a real treat that we have another professor from a different area coming in to have these conversations. And the third reason why I'm really excited about this source is because, and Isabelle told me this, I didn't even realize this when I first identified it as a source I wanted to talk about, is that this was originally published, this memoir was originally published in French. The editor that worked very closely with Eddy in getting this to publication was Francophone, and this is now a source that's not just been like translated into French, but it was originally in English, and then they worked very closely with a French editor, because Eddy also was a Francophone, to make a French version, and that was the very first version that was published. University of Manitoba picked it up, and there's an English version now as well. So for those of you who are interested in engaging with this in French, that text is available for you. You may have noticed that we have started this thing where our French host does reaction videos to our English conversations, and me as the English host does an English reaction to the French conversations. While I was talking with Isabelle when we were prepping this, I was like, maybe the French host should do it. Maybe Christine should do it. But selfishly, I wanted to have this conversation. So we'll do a part two that's en français, like that's just completely in French. But anyway, I hope you enjoy this conversation as much as I feel that I am going to, given the enthusiasm Isabelle has for this text and bringing it to a wider audience. So let's go over to Zoom. Isabelle, thank you so much for joining us. I told you when we first met that this has been a memoir that was on my list since 2020 to talk about for the series. And I'm so excited we have this new series to be able to bring you to talk about it. So thank you so much. Can you introduce yourself before we get into it?
Yes, thank you so much. And thank you for your interest in Eddy Weetaltuk's book. So my name is Isabelle St-Amand. I'm an assistant professor at Queen's University, where I am also like Queen's National Scholar in Francophone Indigenous Literatures. And I worked on the book by Eddy Weetaltuk while I was a short postdoctoral fellow at the University of Manitoba, where the University of Manitoba Press are, and the series First Voices, First Text. So that's how I came in touch with Weetaltuk and his writings.
Yeah, unfortunately, Eddy has passed away, I think, in 2005, if I remember correctly. And so it's really exciting that you are here as someone that wrote the introduction to be able to talk about this as a source, both like as individual passages, but then also like the memoir itself. And there's so many things I know that we want to talk about today, but why don't we dive right into it? And you identified like an introductory passage that we can kind of start the conversation about to talk about what this source is. Is that right?
Yes. So just to tell you just briefly the story, it's a memoir by Eddy Weetaltuk. So it's his memoirs as a war veteran. He was a soldier in the Canadian Army, where he enrolled under a fake name because Inuit could not join the army at the time. And it's also his memoirs as a Inuk man and his memoirs, childhood memories, and how he went through a real life of adventures and his really adventurous spirit and his incisive talk and perspective on life. So it's a very captivating story. It's really interesting to read, and it's a very fresh outlook on the life of the Inuit at that time, and then also of a soldier and the Korean War in the middle of the 20th century. So this is what the story is about. And we could start with the first quote that conveys quite a lot the spirit of that book. So I could read it for you. Yeah.
Okay, great. Let's go over to screen share. Okay, so the section that you want to like highlight as a way to introduce people to this fantastic source, you actually quoted in your introduction, and it's great that it's here, because if we go to the original page, which is 8384, and so people can do that with their own copy, it's just kind of broken up on the page, like it's 83 and then 84. So we'll keep it here in order to be able to read it kind of in one place. And I think you're going to read it to all of us, and I'll just highlight some sections when you're talking. So whenever you're ready.
Okay. Finally, the day came to move. Everyone was quiet except the corporals and sergeants who were screaming out orders all day long. I suspected that my comrades were like me, too anxious to be able to talk. Like most of them, I never wanted to be a hero. I only enrolled because I needed a job. I was only 19 years old and I still had a lot to live for. But instead, I was heading to the front. I seriously thought of deserting, but I knew the punishment. I had already experienced the army detention and I wasn't going to taste it again. Thinking about what I had endured for misplacing my papers, I was sure the treatment for a deserter, especially a deserter enrolled under a fake identity, would have been unbearable. I was also thinking of my Inuit countrymen, and I did not want to bring shame on my people. If I had deserted, everybody would have said that the Inuit are not courageous enough for war. At that point, I thought that I would rather be dead than bring shame on my family. I was probably the first Inuk to go to war. I had to be strong. I had to prove that Inuit are just as courageous as any other people. I was sad thinking I could die without seeing my family, but if my fate was to be killed, I was going to die with dignity. I was determined. I was going to show the world how an Inuk fights and dies.
Thank you so much for reading. But thank you so much for identifying that as like kind of the first way to be introduced to Eddy. There's so much there. There's so much there that both I think people are familiar with in terms of veteran narratives, like being young, being scared, what that looks like. But then adding this extra layer of being Inuk, adding this extra layer of understanding oneself within a broader community and family and culture that has to prove itself to the world for some reason, I think really encapsulates so much of the different elements of why this memoir is so fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and the memoir is really engaging with different things, but what you have is really the changing times that the Inuit were going through at the time. So in his youth, it was in the 1930s, and so there were more and more settlers in the area where he lived like a traditional life with his family, hunting and traveling in with territory. So it's a time when you have the Hudson Bay Company being more and more present, the missionaries, and it's a time also when you have the boarding schools being opened. And so what you have is a moment in his youth where he calls it a time of innocence, because Weetaltuk means the innocent eyes, and he's talking about his youth as a time of innocence with his family, doing their lives and just having a good time. And then he's talking about those times changing, but also how they went through a 7 year of hunger. There was nothing to be hunted, and they were really hungry, and it lasted for a very long time. So that really impacted on him, and he's reflecting a lot on that time in his memoirs, thinking, because he's trying to figure out why he took such a dangerous path to his life. So why he had such a strong quest to be free, to live as a free man. And he really felt like the Inuit could not live as a free people at that time, or as an Inuk himself, he could not live as a free person. Like it was becoming harder to sustain oneself as people had always done. The jobs were not so common, and he really had a strong desire to travel, to see the world, to know what's in the South and everywhere else. So there a big thing has this quest for freedom.
You know, the second question of this series is what is the story? But I feel like we've already jumped in so far, which is just amazing, because there are so many layers to this as a story. So the key element, because it's from tundra to trenches, is his work as a soldier for the Canadian Armed Services for the Korean War, and how he travels to the continent of Europe and the continent of Asia to be able to fight, and all of his adventures there, which is quite interesting because it's like you know, this young man in his early 20s exploring the world, but then also kind of the draws of home and thinking about home and understanding self, which is what I found so moving about the memoir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the parts, he takes a lot of time to go over his childhood and this moment when he decided to go south and how he ended up in the Canadian forces. And then he takes us to the actual front where he spent some considerable time. And he really introduces us to all the, like, the daily life of soldiers at the front. I mean, I haven't read so many war memoirs, but I was struck by the sincerity of his observations and the self-reflection he's having, because he's a soldier, he's enrolled at the war, so he's doing his duty as a soldier. And at the same time, they're going to different villages in Korea, and then they see the women and the children in the villages and what they're enduring because of the war. And then he's thinking about his family back home, and he sees that actually there are very, some things are very similar. And then he's kind of in small bits, he's wondering about the sense of it and the ethics of it and the complexity of things for him as a human being there, but also being there as a soldier. He's also looking at how they go with his fellow soldiers on permission, or when they go to the bars and then they drink and then they meet with women. And so there's a lot of stories of him and his fellows going out with women from the place. And he also has lots of very funny anecdotes and little witty reflections. So, and also he's thinking a lot about being in the trenches and being shot at, and there's explosions all around and you're digging a trench and then you have to retreat. And so he really brings you on the battlefield when your life is so much at stake and you see your comrades falling in combat and how you live with that and how you keep on and the kind of reflections that someone may have. So for me, it was really fascinating to see his perspective of being on the battlefield and at the front and thinking of the global politics from his perspective. As an Inuit man, as a Canadian soldier, but also as a human, embezzled in that crazy time of, I mean, a war is nothing fun. So just seeing the people suffering, no matter which side they are, he shows how he witnesses people's suffering and people's miserable conditions created by these wars. And yet he cannot change anything of that. So, I think it's something that he reflects on his memoir, this whole experience. But I think what is emerging as the dominant thing through his entire story is that he always finds the positive side of things, and he will criticize some things and then he will laugh a little bit about it and then tell an anecdote and then go further. And it's really, really his quest, to really to accomplish himself, but also how to deal with all those obstacles that keep coming his way. And then towards the end, it just becomes harder and harder. And that's at the moment when, after he's out from the army, he comes back home. And then he has this concern for his own community and the youth and writing his memoirs.
Well, he has a great image of him in the trenches. Let's go over to screen share and look at that image really quickly. There are some illustrations of the trenches, which are really interesting in Korea. We have this photograph as well of them kind of talking together. And again, mm-hmm. what's really useful about this book, so thank you, University of Manitoba Press, is that it references the page where they're talking. And what mm-hmm. I find really kind of interesting about these particular moments because they look very familiar if you are looking at, if you're imagining trench warfare, for example. But mm-hmm. if you go and you look at these quotes, and I have it queued up right here, there's such interesting elements about what you were saying about his own struggle to kind of reconcile what he was seeing with what he was personally there for and how his own, you know, like all those different elements. And I just found this quote from one of his comrades, one of his fellow soldiers, so interesting because it shows what, it shows some of the things that Eddie was struggling with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could read it if you.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So they're at the front and it's very rough and very difficult to witness. And so his comrade is seeing that Eddie is having a hard time witnessing all that violence at the front. And he said, Eddie, forget about it. Don't pay attention to wounded guys or you will lose your appetite. I'm not kidding you. You must learn to become insensitive if you want to survive. You must keep all your energy for yourself. Think of your folks. Do you think they want to receive the news of your death? And so, yeah, like you say, it really encapsulates how complex it is to be at the front and how a difficult experience it must be to have to insensitize yourself, but also the fact that you must do that if you want to survive, because it's the only way, it seems, that that this friend is presenting, that this is what you have to do if you want to survive. And then he's trying to think about this, and he's watching actually the enemy line, and when there's napalm that is dropped on the enemy lines, and so he feels like the heat, and he feels all the, he says, no doubt I was in hell. Surprisingly, I would get used to that routine. Every day it was the same thing. And at night we would fight the enemy with our guns and artillery. Then they would fight back. But when the morning came, the American jets would pour tons of napalm over the heads of the North Koreans. It was like we were having two wars at the same time, a conventional one at night and another one during daytime that I can't qualify. So people speak sometimes in moments of war and in moments where you have things such as these happenings, the fact that there are not even words to speak about what is happening. It is so, it's just so horrible and so difficult to go through that you can't even find the words. And it's a little bit what he is bringing up here, like those atrocious experiences of a soldier being in such a front and then having to make sense of it, like first having to survive, like to come back alive as possible, then looking at your comrades being shot in combat, but also looking the enemies being thrown napalm like that in an unconventional war, and then thinking about the ethics of that in a larger scene. So all of those passages really, I don't know, they really highlight the complexity of the situation and how much work Weetaltuk had to do later on to reflect on that experience of yeah. going to war and surviving those battles and just emerging out of that alive and continuing with his life. So there is that. And we discussed earlier on the fact that he was really living a lot of tension around his false identity. And one of the things we see here and that we see just later in that passage is that he was thinking what would happen if he died, if he was killed at the front under a fake identity. So he's thinking that maybe his parents would never be informed about his death because he's not there as Eddy Weetaltuk. And so then he will say towards the end, the very idea that my mother might never know if I was killed was driving me to despair. I was feeling like a dog that would be shot and left to die alone. And so you have this added layer to the whole thing. So not only all of that is happening, he's witnessing that, but also he's thinking of, in case of his own death, his family would not even know what happened to him, which is which is something that drives him to despair. And it's really dehumanizing to think that you would just die and that's it, and you're just gone and your family doesn't know about it. Your parents keep waiting for you the rest of their lives and the like. So this is another example of how difficult it was for him to go under a fake name, a false identity, a borrowed identity.
So, and yeah, that is always so close to him, right? Right. It's mm-hmm. always just on him.
Yes.
You know, the third question in this conversation is how can we use a source like this to challenge Canadian history? And I feel like everything that you talked about points us in that direction, because one of the things that I'm thinking of is that you can use a source like this to be the kind of nucleus around teaching the whole of the 20th century, because we are starting it with his birth in the 1920s, his experiences in residential schools, his experiences in war in the 1950s, and then something we can talk about in a little bit, once he gets back and he faces a hostile, racist Canadian nation that that ignores everything that he was able to do in fighting for the country, but also that doesn't even like legitimate the experiences he's bringing back, right? Like the person that he was overseas is not the person that anybody sees once he gets back. And I can only imagine that is I want to say heartbreaking, but that doesn't really, like, that's just the tip of the iceberg, like kind of soul shaking.
Yeah, and I think that connects with the stories from other Indigenous war vets who went to war, and they were really like Weetaltuk, for instance, in his story, he, in the army, he really finds brotherhood. He's accepted as a full person, and he's really living a life, like albeit under a false identity, but still like he's seen as a full person. And like you mentioned, when he comes back home and there's lots of settlements there, and he experiences a lot of racism from white settler Canadians who look down on him and don't recognize him even as a full person almost, and then don't recognize the service he did as a soldier in the Canadian forces. So it's really a deep disappointment, and also very... very difficult to bear, because he doesn't want to just to be treated like that. And so you can see that towards the end of his life, he really reconnects more and more with his community, and they go live like in a village that is more living on the traditional sense. And he pours a lot of effort into his memoirs.
So when I was reading this book, I was really struck by this part, and it takes place in 1967 when he comes back. And he said that I was no longer a member of the armed forces, but a civilian and treated as such. And then he said, I also came to realize that the North had changed and the new generation of white people here were less friendly. School was not a good thing anymore, but a nightmare for some young. And this was a huge disappointment. I really wanted to like flag this, because I think when we are teaching residential schools, or like the ways that residential schools are brought into the curricula, it seems like it kind of like keeps in the past, like the 1920s, like it was 100 years ago. Oh, it also kind of went through to 1996, but like, remember, it was really the 1920s and 1930s, and you see these old archival photographs. And I think this is such a striking, important reminder that during the centennial, Expo 67 and all of that stuff, that Eddie's experiences of anti-Indigenous racism was even more acute than when he was born in 1923 and he was just given a tag rather than like a name by the Canadian government. And that his impressions of the schools that the students were in right now were so much worse than what he experienced, and that was a disappointment. So it was like he was thinking, well, the schools will get better, and they didn't. And I just really want to flag that if teachers use this as a way to teach about the whole 20th century, that we can't think that in the 1960s, the 1970s, we can't use that progress narrative, because here is Eddie coming home and saying like, it was way worse than I could have even imagined.
It seemed like what he says is like settler colonialism has entrenched itself. So when he was a youth, it was just the beginning of the settlers going there, and the people still were living their traditional lives. So in a sense, they were more in control of their lives despite of the tags and of everything that was coming in. But it seems like at that moment in the north, the colonialism, the settlement had increased somehow. And this about the schools running all the way into the well into the 70s and some even much later, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, in their final report, one of the very negative effects of the residential schools that they highlight is that it really cultivated a lot of racism and disrespect among the settler populations towards the indigenous populations. And so maybe the story doesn't tell us exactly what it is, but the TRC really highlights the fact that the schools really generated a very negative and a racist type of attitude towards indigenous peoples. And so in this paragraph, you have both the school and racism and the intensified settlement that come all together. And so that just makes his return home so inhospitable, and he's just returning home, and it's not a good sight, and it's not a good experience because of that racism and that hatred that they are targeted with. And so I think it makes you remember that residential schools were not in the 19th century past experience, but it was really way into the 20th century. So yeah, so this is an example of that.
I wrote a blog post for Active History a few years ago, doing a little bit of a discourse analysis about some of the storybooks used to teach about residential schools. And what I found was that they often kind of showed residential schools as isolated, just kind of church focus. And there wasn't any sort of accountability to the larger Canadian nation or the populations. And while the picture books are fantastic, and a lot of them were written by Indigenous people or illustrated by Indigenous people, I think that's kind of a dangerous narrative that we might be getting into, to think of residential schools as isolated and not connected to the larger Canadian populations. Because I think you made such an important point when you said, like, here settler colonialism becomes more entrenched. And I wonder what teachers can do with a memoir like this to intersect these experiences of him coming home and his experiences earlier in the 20th century with the fact that Expo 67, and there's a lot of protests happening right now, and the Summer of Love, and all those kind of things that we often teach in that time period. Like, how do we reconcile these experiences that he talks about in his memoir and in a way that kind of demonstrates that it isn't a progress, that settler colonialism shifts and changes, and Eddie's story really shows what that looks like for one person.
Yeah, that's a really good question, and actually it would be very interesting to connect all those events and places in a course for students, like Expo 67 and all the Indigenous affirmation that was there, and then what was happening in Nunavut and Nunavik and James Bay and those places at the same time.
There's one other kind of activity, like a teaching activity, that I immediately thought of when I see these illustrations, which is to like get students to also do illustrations. Like, you know, I think this is such a great memoir to be able to be like, okay, well, here is the illustration of this section. Use this method to illustrate other sections. And like, I would love to see that. So do that, teachers, and send
Isabelle
and I those images, because I think that, like, what a rich, like, resource that you can create for that too. Mm-hmm. I know you talked a little bit about how this book came to press. And just as we're ending, mm-hmm. I just want to kind of come back to some of that so people mm-hmm. know where they can find it. One of the things that you told me when we connected, which I didn't know, is that this was originally published in French, which means that this mm-hmm. is a resource mm-hmm. or this is a memoir that can be accessed mm-hmm. in English and in French, which I think is just mm-hmm. amazing. So can you just give us a little bit more information about how we can get this book and how it came to press?
Yes. So the French version was published in Carnet du Nord in France in the, I think, 2009. And so it was published first in French because they were not able to find an English publisher. And Thibault Martin, who's from France originally, managed to get that book published in France. And it's easier for also being in France so they don't have to engage with the Canadian history, right, in the same way. And so, and then they worked with the University of Manitoba Press and their series, First Voices, First Text, which is a very interesting series. So it focuses on underappreciated texts by Indigenous authors. So what they want to do is they want to reconnect the readers with important texts that we may not have read. And so the editing process is also very careful. So it really is about working with the author, with his family, with the community, and really creating something that is through the process, something that that is ethical and that makes sense. And this is what they did with Thibault Martin and Eddy Weetaltuk. So after they reviewed the entire manuscript, Eddie passed away, but it was agreed that it was going to the opportunity to work with Thibault Martin, as he was himself very sick, and he eventually passed away just as after the book was published. And so Thibault Martin also had this dream to publish this book at all costs during his lifetime. And so I worked with him at the end of his life to get all the things together and just write the introduction and organize like the last bits of the book. And so it can be found at University of Manitoba Press. You can have a PDF, you can have a print version like that. And so it's just a fascinating story, actually. There's nothing I can tell that is even starting to equate what the book is about. But so I really recommend people to jump into that life story and read it. It's really, it's a great story.
I know, like every time, this is a mean thing to say on the video to people, because every time we've gone to screen share and I know we'll like cut stuff out and we're just kind of like sorting through the passage we're going to talk about, we keep like talking about these other stories and it's like, oh my God, there's no way that we can like talk about everything here. And that's why this has been such a wonderful conversation, because people will really, really love reading this as a memoir, but also I think love using it as a teaching tool. And because mm-hmm. it's through University of Manitoba Press, I mean, it's fairly affordable. It's not like some books that are like, oh, $150 and you'll get it in 3 months. Like, especially because people can access it as a PDF. And I just really want to say thank you so much, Isabelle, for sharing your enthusiasm for this memoir, sharing so many stories that come from a source like this, and really helping us understand the different layers of it. So it can be brought in the classroom really explicitly to challenge Canadian history.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, I would be looking forward to hearing other readers' impressions of that amazing life story.
Thank you again. It was great. Let's stay in touch. We'll obviously teach your materials. And until next time, see you later.
Thank you so much. It was great talking about the Weetaltuk life story. Thank you so much.
Bye. Hey everyone, we hope you enjoyed that video as much as we enjoyed making it. If you did, make sure you like below. Also comment and let us know how you're thinking of using this in the classroom. Check out the playlist that we have specially curated for you so that you don't miss a video from this season, or that you get to see other videos related to this topic that we curated especially for you. However, I also want you to subscribe. We're reaching the end of our season, but we have a whole new season coming out in September that we want to make sure that you know about. We also have a whole series of videos coming out this summer called Short Stories, Petite Histoire, from community members who are showing you sources that you can use in your classroom. We know that summer's coming up and that you are going to need a break, but we're also going to have a no stress, no fuss, just go for a walk and do some thinking professional development. And we want to make sure that you know about that as well. So make sure you subscribe, like, comment, check out our playlist here, and keep an eye on all of our social media so that you know when our no stress, no fuss, just go for a walk and do some thinking professional development starts for the summer. Have a great day.